to Magic TV. I'm Tristan Shaun Gregson here with Luis Scott-Vargas. Pretty exciting right now. We're kind of like ahead of the game on spoilers for the new set.
Yeah, we're just going to be talking about NPH today. That would be new Phyrexia.
Oh, so close. Okay, I guess we could do that. Thanks to the Japanese in some variety or another, we had quite a few cards.
Yeah, MTG Salvation got a bunch of Japanese cards, which were then translated, and although we obviously can't verify the translation because I personally don't speak Japanese yet. Not that I'm taking any steps to correct that. these translations might be a little rough, but we're just gonna run with them for now.
Yeah, I think the most important thing is the number one card we're gonna talk about today. Let's come right out of the gate with it. Everyone wants to talk about Karn.
Yeah, colorless planeswalker. I wish he was an artifact so he could tinker him out in Vintage, but that would probably be too good.
Sounds like that would be an upside against it.
So he starts with 6 loyalty?
Yes.
Okay, so 7 mana, 6 loyalty. +4, exile target card from a player. Target player exiles a card from their hand.
Right, so you can do it to yourself or your opponent.
-3, exile target permanent. -14, restart the game, and you start with all the permanents exiled by Karn.
Yes, so...
So basically what he does is he Lilianas them, you know, making them discard a card. Or yourself if you want to store a guy in exile. And then he just vindicates anything. And then when you ultimate him, you get whatever cards you exiled, which gives you incentive to exile your own stuff. Though... I would say that probably 9 out of 10 times you're just going to be hitting them because you just get value.
this card is so absurd.
It's very powerful. It's 7 mana. 7 mana is a lot of mana, just to keep things in perspective.
I guess. I mean, Nicol Bolas was 8 and it was spread across 3 different colors. This guy is just...
Yeah. Well, for 7 mana, like, he's 10 loyalty the turn he comes into play if you plus him, which means creatures aren't going to kill him. And they do have to discard a card, which isn't, like, huge, but the second time is a lot worse. But the -3, like... Playing him vindicating their only threat is insane. But again, he's 7 mana. I mean, that's the point where they've already cast a Primeval Titan, or they're casting, like, you know, they've got a bunch of guys out. Still, I expect him to see play just because he's that powerful.
I mean...
He's not a card you want to run a bunch of.
I guess. 7 mana really doesn't seem like it's that absurd, though. I mean, he's got these ramp decks. I mean, think of what Eldrazi Green used to be very recently.
Right, and Eldrazi Green's kind of making a comeback, but still, 7 mana, like, you could cast Primeval Titan and win the game.
It just seems like the whole game shifts once this guy comes into play. Again, if...
7 mana spells tend to do that.
Okay. You know, 10 loyalty is absurd. I mean, you thought like 8 from Nicol Bolas was absurd.
I mean, his weakness isn't to creatures. It's really to counter spells and the fact that like aggro decks are just running you over by them. But I mean, if blue-white decks are playing Spine of Ishshaa to go with their Venser, like Karn's just going to be better, I think. Because by himself, he's like, you know, Spine if you really need to. Or, like, you know, come to play, kill their best threat. Next turn, they maybe can't kill him, then you just +4 him. I mean, his ultimate will happen. It's only 2 turns. Like, I mean, granted, you only get 2 cards, but starting the game with 2 cards versus their none is pretty sweet. Well, 2 cards in play versus their none in play.
Yeah, and that's kind of where the translation is kind of awkward. The restart the game, like,
I assume
phrasing,
that means both players have 7 cards, 20 life.
That would be pretty crazy.
So, yeah, Karn, I think, is something that we're going to see. See a lot of speculation on, at the very least.
Already starting here. I mean, he seems way ahead of the curve to me. That's what I've got to say.
I wouldn't use way ahead of the curve, but I think he's good.
Well, let's talk about the one card that we know 100% for sure, everything about it, because it was the official spoiler card from Wizards.
Oh, the Grand Cenobite?
Yes, yes. Elesh Norn, the bye-bye Krovax, hello new giant guy.
The extra mana is a lot. I mean, I'll admit that. But the effect it has is actually really good. It gives all their guys -2/-2, and all your guys +2/+2. It's like a 5/7 or something?
A 4/7 Vigilance.
4/7 Vigilance, sure. So it's kind of like a Masker Worm that sticks around and pumps all your guys. I would expect us to see some play, but I don't expect it. Like, that's the problem with the Titan series, if I may take a second to complain about the fact they're coming back in M12.
You can do that.
Titans are just too good. Like they're all insane. They all basically outclass any creature to cost between 5 or more mana. At that point, just cast a Titan. They just win you the game so easily that it makes cards like this, which would be, I think, otherwise more interesting, just less interesting. I mean, why cast this when you can cast Sun Titan a turn earlier and then, you know, just smash them, or cast Grave Titan, or cast, you know, obviously Primeval Titan even has a deck built around him. So I think it would be nice to have a break from the Titans, as sweet as they were a great. You know, they're a great cycle, but I would not have minded them going away now. So that's one of the problems with Elesh Norn.
She has an effect very similar to Inferno Titan being able to kill your opponent's guys, or Grave Titan being able to make threats.
Yeah, deal with 2/2s. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, immediately there was talk between people I know of, you know, legacy implications. This seems like a...
Legacy?
A good dredge target.
So this is your pick for the best Legacy card, much like Horrifying Revelation was in the prior episodes.
I'm just trying to talk about other stuff. No one, does, you don't ever
you're
see
right,
that.
This is a good sideboard card for Merfolk for the mirror. They can vial it in at 7.
You're terrible.
Yeah, just TSG, Breaking Legacy, one card at a time.
You know, so I don't play that format. And
I wouldn't have known if you hadn't told me.
Phyrexian Unlife seems pretty interesting to me. This is one you weren't too excited about, though.
Yeah, I said it seems uninteresting. I mean, it's just basically gain 10 life, right? Because when you hit 0, you don't die, but everything has poison now. So, I mean, what does it do better than just gaining 10 life? I mean, gaining 10 life for 3 mana is not bad, though multiples do nothing. And if they do have an enchantment removal, obviously you just die. Because you go to 0, and it's like any damage that would cause you to go below 0 is instead poison.
Let me make sure here.
Because what if you're at 1 and they hit you with like a 3-3?
Oh, sources that deal damage now have infect.
Once you're at 0 life.
As long as your life total is 0
okay,
or
so,
less.
Okay, so when you're at like 1 and you hit by like their attack, you just go to negative 5. And then next turn their guys all have infect. So, I mean, it's interesting. Against a red deck like that can't get rid of it, I mean, white 2, gain 10 life is probably worth it. But, I don't know, it's like a sweet one of. I would not want to play multiples, maybe 2 at most, because drawing 2 does just absolutely nothing.
It also doesn't seem like a main deck card.
Definitely not. But at least, I mean, it's somewhat interesting. I wouldn't say it's completely uninteresting, but
well, that's an upgrade on the scale of LSV caring. Yeah. All right, that's good. Let's move on to a card that we've all been talking about. That's the Pure Steel Paladin, the new.
Yeah, like white, 2/2. Whenever you play an equipment, draw a card, and Metalcraft, your equipment's free to equip. I mean, this rewards you for playing a bunch of equipment, which the white decks already are doing. And it's on equipment whenever you cast an equipment or when it comes into play.
I've got to be cast, right? No, enters the battlefield.
Ooh, so when you Stoneforge in or quest in, yeah, that's value. I mean, I don't know if this is what it takes to make a mono white deck good enough. Probably not. But I'd probably try these in Boros at the very least. Like the Boros deck I have is, you know, 4 equipments in it, and this gives you incentive to play a bunch more. The Metalcraft equip free part is maybe not as relevant, but I mean, in block, this might be good to play a bunch of swords or whatever.
Yeah, I mean, I hadn't thought of it from the aspect where it's like, well, you're just getting a bear that, you know, then you might draw some cards out and get value out of it. Not like, well, you know, what's the most expensive thing? Like my Argentum armor is all of a sudden I can get.
I mean, I wouldn't go nuts with Argentum armor, but that might be okay. And drawing, as long as you draw one card out of it, it's not that bad. And doesn't seem that hard, especially with like adventuring gear to like play him next turn, play adventuring gear, equip, attack for 6, play another adventuring gear, you know, like, you know, just keep going off. It rewards you for playing a lot of equipment, which I think is good.
It's an officially costed creature that has the keyword on it that says, you know, draw a card.
Yeah, obviously I'm going to like that.
Again, going to Value Town. We have the new Negator.
Yeah, the first time I read this, I thought it was just a Negator that cost 4 black. I was like, this card is terrible. Then I figured out what it did, and I'm like, oh, it's only mediocre. Okay, maybe exaggerating. I actually do like the card. It's just, right now, this is another card, you know, getting oppressed by the best cards in Standard. Jace is going to make this card a joke. Like, the problem is you can't play 4 or 5 mana guys that just get bounced by Jace. Like, look at Hero of Bladehold. It's seeing a marginal mana play, but if Jace weren't here, it'd be seeing a ton more. Like, there just aren't. It's just not feasible to play cards like this that if you play them and then they play Jace and bounce it, you lose. I mean, that just kind of sucks. He seems like he'd be pretty good in block if there's a mono black deck, though. He doesn't have Infect. That's kind of problematic because all of Block's best creatures all have Infect.
Ah, there's
like
the key.
Crusader and Batmother and stuff like that. But, I mean, a Canceler, whenever they deal damage to him, they sack permanents. It's basically just untouchable. Like, I mean, go for the throat kills it, but, I mean, what are you going to do, Lightning Bolt this guy? Like, that seems like punishment.
Yeah. Seems
being
pretty
able,
bad.
Being able to kill him, you have to sack 5 permanents to kill him. Like, that's pretty sick, so.
Yeah, I mean, the entire time you're talking, I was saying, like, Abyssal Persecutor fell into the same trap where it's like, yeah, it seems so like, great.
Abyssal Persecutor is a very good card, but it just, Jace, the fact that it's in the same set as Jace meant that it never saw, like, you know, really feasible play.
But, I mean, like, I think that, unlike Abyssal Persecutor, this card definitely has already light in a tunnel you can see because it's not going to be in a standard environment.
Right, they're not reprinting Jace. That I'm, like, very sure about.
Right,
and
yeah.
So soon enough, he'll be able to, like, shine without Jace. And at that point, I think he gets much more interesting.
Yeah, I mean, so,
I don't want to, like, you know, just say all these new cards are terrible because they're definitely not. But the old cards are still, you know, oppressing them, like Titans and Jace, are still making it hard for new cards to break in. And that's kind of the problem. The best cards tend to stay the best cards. It's hard to top them.
And it doesn't have a lot of synergy with the black decks right now. I mean, you're like, it's not a vampire, like, and it doesn't have an infect.
Yeah, the best attacking black deck right now is probably, like, you know, Kibler's blue-black poison control deck, you know, because the vampire deck's still kind of eh.
You just need to be able to run 8 blood gas, and it's a different story.
Yeah, well, if you could do that, then we'd be talking.
Praetor's Grip. Ooh, this is actually a good one.
No, Grim Tutor, like, you know, you search their library for a card, exile it, and then you can play it. So it's kind of like Extract. You know, you could play it against a deck where they have one Tendrils or something. But it's also interesting, and it's like a 3-mana tutor for their a card from their deck. I'm not saying it would be good in Standard, just because Standard decks not only tend to be more redundant, there's also less cards that, you know, give you back the mana you invested. Like in Type 1, if you tutor for an Ancestral and play it, you still got good mana value. But whereas in Type 2, like, that just doesn't work. But in older formats, this could be something very interesting.
Yeah, it's actually very nice that this card is black, because it doesn't seem like there are a lot of black decks that... I was just thinking, like, right now, if you were to have this card in Standard today, Sword of Feast and Famine. Like, you could get that card out of the blue-eyed decks.
Yeah, but a lot of the blue-eyed decks running two now, and getting one sword out of their deck, just not an effective use of mana.
So you're exploiting the players that only run one. Otherwise, it's like, get your one of your JC.
If you can cast this, like, before they cast Stoneforge Mystic. The problem is, again, all Standard decks are just so redundant. Like, you can go get a Primeval Titan and then cast it, but... Maybe. I mean, it's a card that maybe sideboard... in case there's like something specific in a matchup you want access to, if there's a card powerful enough that you want six of them in your deck or something. I mean, you also have to be playing somewhat the same colors as your opponent to really take advantage.
Yeah, I mean, they're joking, like, it's never bad, you can always just get a land.
It's just interesting to look at because it does something that no card's ever done before, at least exactly the same way. So, I mean, that's worth taking a look at.
It's an exciting card to play with. I mean, again, talk around the office rarely centers around casual formats from the people that work here. So I was like, you know, you guys don't even think about EDH. Like, all of a sudden, five opponents? Like, oh, yeah. Whose library am I going after?
Yeah,
like,
where can I get Sol Ring? Because I always want Sol Ring.
Fair enough. So
whenever I cast Trinket Mage EDH, it's always to get Sol Ring. Or Sensei's Job. Basically, those are the two I get.
Okay, so. Both good targets for this card. Any deck can cast them. And so I think this card...
Not as much. Tap it, put it on the deck.
You're not going to do that.
Right, that's what makes it a little worse. But
you'll actually see a top go to someone's graveyard. See, yeah. That'll be exciting. But I think this card will always have value. It'll always be good, even if it's not good in Standard. Like, I think it's going to be a lot of fun to play with.
Yeah.
Spawning Shell, what do you think about that one?
This is one of the more interesting cards. So it's like kind of like your Rebel Chaining. It's like 3 and a green Phyrexian mana. Speaking of which, the Phyrexian mana...
That's kind of a big deal.
Key to each color. It costs either like that color or 2 life. So you could play this in a non-green deck. It just costs 3 mana and 2 life. Or you can pay 3 and a green. And the Phyrexian mana is very powerful because the life cost isn't very much in the beginning, but a lot of them have recurring costs, and then it gets a lot more, you know, problematic. Like, Ancient Tomb's insane the first 2 times you tap it. The 3rd and 4th time, it starts actually adding up. So this I expect to be cast for 3 mana most of the time, but its activation is 1 and a green Phyrexian mana, which I expect to be paid more often than not. But for 1 and a Phyrexian mana tap, you can sack any creature as a sorcery and get a creature with its converted mana cost or less. Out of your deck, into play.
Is that converted mana cost or less?
Or is it exact? It's not exact mana cost, is it?
No, it's up. It's let me read what it says right here. Sacrifice creature, search your library for a creature with converted mana cost equal to the sacrifice creature converted mana cost plus 1.
Oh, plus 1. So yeah. It is. So it chains up.
It is chaining. Yeah. Because when I first heard it, it was like, oh, you know, new food chain.
Yeah. No. So that's pretty sweet. It does something pretty powerful. And like upgrading, you know, Vengevine into another Vengevine or Vengevine into Baneslayer, you know, you start with Lotus Cobra and you get, you know, something sweet that costs 3, like...
I mean, just like, Birds of Paradise on turn, like, 8, all of a sudden...
Becomes Stoneforge Mystics, you know,
yeah.
Or Fauna Shamans.
Yeah.
It's the kind of deck that uses Fauna Shaman, I think, would like this. Sacking Vengevine to get something sweet, you know, is pretty nice, too, because you get the Vengevine back.
Yeah, these seem like they're kind of attached together as soon as you saw the spoiler.
I mean, it's the kind of card you want to build around, but you don't really want to draw multiples of, because it's just like... kind of unwieldy. Having 2 doesn't really help that much.
Yeah, it's not like Fauna Shaman where you could pitch one to the other.
Right.
This card
so
is like...
it's the kind of card you want to build around with Fauna Shamans maybe and play like 2 or 3 in your deck. But it's, again, another card you definitely want to look out for because when you look at cards as powerful and new as this, then, you know, they're the cards that tend to do things.
It has an effect strong enough. I mean, that's the important thing. Like, right. It's obviously going to do something.
Yeah.
Hex Parasite was also pretty exciting. It has the key words on it, which I think... are the closest thing you're going to see to destroy target planeswalker like in this day and
age. It seems pretty excellent, like to play it and then immediately kill their planeswalker first.
That's what happens when I don't like trade off with you on these things. Like it gives you time to meld something. Just terrible, in my opinion. So
can we talk about the card?
Yeah,
instead of my
fire away.
Insanely good jokes.
You sure you don't? Yeah, I was going to say you don't mind that I'm stopping on this, so we can just kind of. Anyway, what does it do?
So it's X and a black Phyrexian mana.
Yes.
And remove X counters from a permanent, or up to X counters from a permanent. It gets +1/+0 for every counter removed. So it's a 1-mana 1/1 that, like, you can, you know, fire breathe it. But the good part is you just you kill Planeswalkers. For 4 mana, you can play it, pay 2 life, and tap 3 and just kill Jace immediately. And even though Jace is on his way out, it's still like definitely worth looking at just because of that. I'd much rather do that than try to piving needle a Jace, you know?
Yeah, and again, it's not just about Jace, it's about Planeswalkers in general. I mean,
yeah, imagine this against Everflowing Chalice. Like, it's a nice little stone right there.
Yeah, it takes the counters off the Tumble Magnet, seems pretty important. Yeah.
I mean, there are definitely decks where you'd want this, and if people, I mean, people were playing Vector Asp at the last approach, or not that they're right, I think that deck was horrible, but like, you, if you want to play Vector Asp, this is a lot better. Of course, that's true of basically any legal standard card, so.
I was going to say, I'd probably like that argument.
I still can't believe Owen played against, you know, his opponent cast Vector Asp against him when they're playing for top 16 of the Pro Tour and $7,000. And then he ousted it twice, and his opponent played 3 Vector Asps in a row. Yeah, Owen didn't lose that game. I mean, the deck did well. It was playing for top 16, obviously, but still, Vector Asp, like.
I think the moral of this story was this card is nowhere close to that. It is actually pretty decent.
It could be. I mean, it's kind of like a Vampire Hexmage for other colors.
The next generation.
It's a little expensive to kill Gideon, I will give you that. But the fact that it is just X and 2 life means any color can play it pretty easily. And, I don't know, it seems pretty reasonable. Like, as more things use counters, it gets much, much better. It's very obvious. Like, you know, the more things like Everflowing Chalice that, you know, Tumble Magnet that people are playing, the better this card gets.
You know, regrowing your guys that have had infect counters put on them, for instance, if that's a direction the standard's going to go.
Is it a common or uncommon or rare? I mean, it's not common. I wouldn't be surprised if it was rare, I guess.
It's rare.
Okay. You know, I was going to say, if it was uncommon, it'd be insane and limited, but, you know, in some matchups. But rare, I guess that makes it a little less relevant. So, what's next?
That's the last card on the list, dude.
That's it?
I think so.
Man.
I'm here on the last page of our our three.
I mean, there are some other sweet cards spoiled, but those seem like the most interesting on the face of it.
Yeah, we were really afraid we were going to spend half an hour just talking about Karns. We were like, I should only pick like 5 or 6, but that was not much of a debate. No, that's everything.
I mean,
yeah.
I do like the Stone Rend guy, the elemental. It's like red 3/3/2. When it comes into play, you exile one of their lands.
Oh.
And then whenever that land comes into play, they take 2 damage.
So it's like an Ankh. It's not like a Stone Rend. Oh, it also Stone Rend's a guy. Yeah. It's like
so
a combination.
Obviously,
of
against Valakut, it's like an acidic slime, and it also punishes them for fetching up mountains. But the problem is, they'll just kill it with Valakut.
Right, so you take their Valakut.
You can take Valakut, then they take damage every time they play a Valakut.
Ooh.
I mean, it's not the worst. When it dies, they don't get the land back. I mean, it's just gone.
Oh, okay.
So it's not a nightmare, you know?
Nice.
But,
and a callback to Torment. Very nice.
Right.
Anything else? I mean, we could go back to Karn. Like, is this guy real? You really restart the game. That seems absurd, right?
But that means you're paying a 7-mana spell, and they can't attack it for 2 turns. Right?
I guess.
I mean, the thing is, Standard's really fast right now. Like, look at how much the die roll matters. Look at how many decks are planning to play turn 2 Stoneforge Mystic or turn 4 Primeval Titan. Like, every deck is doing, like, has a critical turn by, like, turn 4.
I mean, like, I'm immediately like, okay, Overgrown Battlement, Growth Spasm.
Yeah, if there's a mono green Eldrazi deck, this is good, especially since the main sideboard card people have against the ramp decks right now are 4 Flash Freeze. And you can't Flash Freeze Karn, obviously, so. Instead of curving into Primeval Titan, you curve into Karn, and I mean, they can still mana leak it, and you can't Summoning Trap, so. I think, again, the jury's still out on this. As long as Stoneforge Mystic and, you know, Valakut decks are around, we'll see if, like, in some matchups, this is going to be pretty good, but right now, it seems like Standard's a little too fast for it.
Yeah, I mean, it's awkward for me.
Karn's going to be around a while, and it's obviously very powerful.
Right.
So it's going to be hard to argue against this card seeing play.
Right. And again, like, I have to put my financial hat on when I come in the ring here, because we usually just
definitely
talk about
the card's going to be expensive.
But, you know, there's so many people that feel like they've been burned recently with, especially after Scars of Mirrodin, where it's, you know, I'm going to get these Planeswalkers right out of the gate. They're going to be so expensive, and they do nothing but plummet in value.
Well,
and it's like, if Karn comes out there as like $50, $60, everyone's like,
Like I said, I don't know that side of it too much. So.
I'm grilling you about playability. Like, I got to know these things. So.
Right now, I don't think Karn's going to come out of the gate and be an all-star. He's not like, you know, not like Jace. He's not even like Gideon or Tezzeret, like, which I've seen a fair amount of play. I would say Karn is more of a niche card than that. But as, you know, as the sets rotate, I would look to Karn. I think in block, for example, as relevant as that is, I don't know, he's going to be pretty good. So he's certainly a Karn to watch out for.
Definitely weigh in the comments on this guy, because. Yeah. You know, you get a lot of players immediately, you see like the Planeswalker of the set, and it's like, this is the greatest thing ever. And
he's definitely a hit, not a myth, though, to preview a segment that we're going to be doing at some
Luis's
point.
Luis's favorite. If it's not ripping on me, it's hit or myth. Those are the things that he he likes.
Well, and the top 8 for this week, which happens to be blue cards. So
it's so hard to work with him sometimes. It's like blue cards. I was like, why don't we do red or green? And just like, no, blue cards.
Well, it's going to be as a top 8 every week. We're eventually going to get to all the colors. And by that, I mean top 8 blue cards, top 8 card drawing.
Luis will be out of the country 1 week, and I'll just get an email from him being like, all right, do the white ones. And we're like,
ah. So, until next time, these are the new spoiler cards, and
pretty
thanks
exciting.
For watching.
't know whose that is. Is that yours?
It's mine. I brought it.
No.
I also just spilled it all over myself.
Can't be trouble to get any work done before the show, but you can make sure to put your water bottle over here. Junk.
You'd think that after a year or more, you would have known how to put
she's
on
the mic. That's gonna hit.
I always try a different position. In the hope that it'll work out better.
Yeah. All right, well, there's nothing I can say about that. This doesn't set itself up for any jokes, so.
Nope.
Too bad there's a big ass on camera with probably some crack showing.
It's okay.
Yeah, there's a big, but the problem is there's still a big ass on camera. It's wearing a hockey jersey.
I don't know why.
That one made it.